UFC Vegas 8 is in the books. We lost Ankalaev and Cutelaba again. There were a few more decisions than I wanted to see, but overall, this was a pretty good night of fights. Here's the winners and losers of UFC Vegas 8. The first fight of the night was a women's strawweight bout between Mallory Martin and Hannah Cyphers. This was a fun one. Mallory wins this one by a second round rear naked choke, but the first round was all Hannah Cyphers. About halfway through the first round, she drops Martin, and it's just all over her. Referee Chris Tione, true to form, lets the fight go and is instructing Mallory to do something to fight back. And Mallory did a great job of surviving this round and listening to the referee and doing just enough to keep the fight going. Martin's corner advises her, hey, you got to take this down to the ground as soon as the second round starts. And that's exactly what she did. As soon as it started, the second round, Mallory took her down and pretty quickly slapped on a beautifully executed choke and finished the fight. It was good enough to award her performance of the night honors, and she gets her first UFC win. She showed great discipline, heeding the referee's instruction, listening to her corner's advice. You could just see the emotion pouring out of her after she got that win. I know it's a big relief off of her shoulders to get that first UFC win. And for these reasons, I gotta call Mallory Martin the big winner. Hannah, on the other hand, she misses weight. She comes in 1 pound too much. 2020 has not been Hannah's year. She has taken the Octagon 4 times, and that's admirable. But she's lost all 4 of them this year. That's 4 in a row. She came close to winning this one. As mentioned, she looked like she was gonna finish it in the first round, but she was unable to capitalize. And so for those reasons, I got to call Hannah Cyphers a loser. The second fight of the night was another women's flyweight bout, this time between Pollyanna Viana and Emily Whitmire. Viana wins this one in the first round by armbar in less than 2 minutes. The fight was really kind of short. Viana didn't show us a whole lot because of its duration, but what she did show us was quite impressive. Viana breaks a 3-fight losing streak here, and she looks great in the process. She notches the 5th fastest submission in strawweight history, which that's pretty cool. Fun fact, the first fastest submission in strawweight history is actually Emily Whitmire. Pollyanna landed some great elbows from the bottom off of her back and kept Whitmire busy in the guard. Whitmire initiated that takedown, got it, and Pollyanna did some damage down there. Just didn't allow Whitmire to focus on advancing to a better position or getting any type of submission off. She had to focus on defending those elbows from the bottom. Eventually, Pollyanna was able to isolate that arm and get the submission. It was really kind of the picture-perfect armbar. She's 1 of 2 underdogs to win tonight. So, Pollyanna Viana, big winner. Welterweight bout, we see Sean Brady take on Christian Aguilera. Brady wins this one by a guillotine choke in the second round. He also gets performance of the night honors, and he stays undefeated. The stand-up fight was quite entertaining, but it was the groundwork that was so impressive here. Brady hit a perfectly timed takedown, and he just advanced position until he was exactly where he wanted to be. He had a one-arm guillotine. Man, it's about as nasty as it gets. He put Aguilera to sleep quickly. Aguilera had just very little time to try to escape the choke. A second or two into it, he appeared to be trying to tap and then convulsing and then asleep. Now, that choke just had to be super tight. Brady's back muscles are popping. I can't imagine how strong he is or the torque that dude can apply. Brady's 3-0 in the UFC now. As mentioned, undefeated. And the future's looking bright for this kid. He's the biggest favorite on the card, so I know he was expected to win, but it was still pretty impressive. Sean Brady, big winner. Next up is a featherweight bout between Alex Caceres and newcomer Austin Springer. Caceres finishes this one by a rear naked choke in the first round, right about the 3.5-minute mark. Bruce Leroy rolls in here looking like a young man, agile and spry and accurate and full of the swagger that we love him for. He's always fun to watch, of course, but he was always going to win this fight. I'm not sure it was a very tough test for him, but he does string together 3 wins in a row now and look good doing it. As mentioned, Austin Springer, he's a newcomer, but he's also a very late replacement. Jiga Chikadze was supposed to have this fight, but he tested positive for COVID on Wednesday. So Springer is the late replacement. Probably didn't get much of a full camp. He comes in 5 pounds overweight even. But still, Caceres looked good in this one, and we got to call him a winner. Moving on up to the main card, in a featherweight bout, we have Ricardo Lamas and newcomer Bill Algeo. Now, this was a fantastic fight that ended with a unanimous decision for Lamas. Algeo looked really good making his UFC debut. He even decisively won the second round. Algeo is very clever with his strikes, with his knees, and proved to be pretty difficult to take down. In the second round, as Lamas came at him, was advancing, Algeo hit him clean in the chin with a knee up the middle that made Lamas taste colors for a minute. But Algeo did look to gas a little bit in the third round. I'm not sure if that was nerves, if it was a gas tank, or if it's just that he got outgamed by the veteran Ricardo Lamas. It looked like the tide was turning a little bit in Algeo's direction in the second round, of course, but Lamas showed his grit and just totally took over that third round and won it 10-8 on all scorecards. Algeo was game. He even gave Lamas a death stare at the end of the first round. He was showboating a little bit, saluting Lamas' missed strikes. But what I really liked was when Lamas landed the high kick and saluted him back, Algeo just laughed and gave him a high five as if it's all fun and games in there. I love seeing stuff like that. This whole fight was a lot of fun. I look forward to seeing more of Algeo. I hope we get to see more of Lamas, but if not, man, thanks for the years, Ricky, and good luck moving forward. To me, both Bill Algeo and Ricardo Lamas were big winners. Next up was a women's flyweight bout between Ji-Yeon Kim and Alexa Grasso. Grasso was making her debut as a flyweight, and she wins this one by a unanimous decision. Grasso's boxing was just on point, popping Kim with combos all throughout the fight. Kim was walking Grasso down, and she kept trying to corner her, pin her into the cage, but Grasso would just slide out of the way as soon as Kim got near. Her boxing was very impressive, but she really looked good everywhere. Grasso landed good leg kicks, she displayed good movement, and when Kim tried to close the distance to change the fight up a little bit, Grasso won the clinch battle too, and even got the takedown. As the third round was ending and Grasso had the fight easily wrapped up and in the bag, she stayed active, using ground and pound, and she definitely could have just coasted for the win. And I just really love to see that kind of stuff. I think that Grasso's going to make a home in the flyweight division, and she'll surely have a pretty low number next to her name pretty soon. So we got to call Alexa Grasso a big winner. The co-main event was a welterweight bout between Neil Magny and fan favorite Robbie Lawler. This was a fight that Magny should win pretty much every time, but it was the way he did it that was really quite impressive. Magny gets his 17th welterweight win, which is second of all time behind only GSP, who's got 19, and it's Magny's third win this year. He wins by unanimous decision and really had a pretty easy time doing it. His jiu-jitsu was really on display here, looking like he probably could have gotten a submission if he really just chose one and went for it. Magny controlled Robbie in the clinch, consistently pushing his head down towards the mat and putting Robbie's body wherever he wanted to. Standing up, Magny was the much more active striker, which we probably would have guessed that, but he landed, over 100 more strikes than Robbie did. In true Magny fashion here, he kept the pace super fast through the entire fight. He was just peppering Robbie with strikes the whole time while standing and threatening submissions on the ground. And this was always Neil's fight to win and to climb the rankings And like I said, he made it look so easy. But, you know, now with four losses in a row for Robbie and suffering another pretty dominant defeat, it'd be easy to chalk up Robbie as a loser here, but I'm going to refrain from that because he was never going to win this one, especially on a short camp. I do hope that we can see ruthless Robbie Lawler again in the UFC, but if not, then we're going to have a lot of fun watching him over in Bellator. All things considered, this was Neil's fight, but he is inching closer to that record of GSP's. He did make it look easy. He did look good. He is going to climb the ranks, so we got to call Neil Magny a winner here. The main event was light heavyweights Anthony Smith and Alexander Rakic. Rakic wins by unanimous decision, but I was pretty unimpressed in this one. You know, they're fighting for that unspoken next shot at the belt, and I just don't think they really delivered here. While they were standing, there was some pretty good action. Hard leg kicks, a couple of vicious strikes, but they just weren't standing long enough. Most of each round was Rakic on top of Smith, keeping his position, landing some short strikes. Although a dominant performance, I don't know why Rakic was so content to just stay on the ground. Smith had no answer for him. He was beaten everywhere, but Rakic just didn't seem to want to close the show. With the belt vacant and John Jones out of the picture, all other light heavyweights finally have their chance to grab the title. This was Smith and Rakic's chance to make a statement, place their bid on the winner of Reyes and Blachowicz. Obviously, Smith didn't do it, but I don't think that Rakic did either. Rakic should have stood up. He should have tried to KO Smith while he's having trouble standing on that damaged leg. I feel like Rakic probably should have demanded that the fight be five rounds just to prove that he's championship ready. With Glover Teixeira and Thiago Santos fighting later in September, I feel that Smith, and particularly Rakic, have just kind of simply passed the baton to them and are begging them to make the statement that they didn't, to stake their claim as the first challenger to the new champion. If they don't, then I feel like Prochazka may even be that guy. You know, Rakic lost his last fight to Uzdemir. That was who Prochazka did away with in an impressive fashion. So I just don't think that Rakic is going to get that next fight, even though he's kind of petitioning for it. I think that they both blew a big chance here. The division is wide open, and it hasn't been in like a decade. And right now, it's important to perform on that higher level. I don't think that either fighter sees that opportunity. And so to me, I got to put them both on my losers list. So there's my real winners and losers of UFC Vegas 8. We've got another big fight coming up this weekend, headlined by Alistair Overeem and Augustus Sakai. Again, another big fight where it's very important to perform really well, and I can't wait to see it. Come back when we make our predictions here in a couple of days. Till next time.